Welcome to the InfoWars Nightly News. It is Tuesday, June 9th, 2015, and I'm Leanne McAdoo. Here's a look at tonight's stories.
Tonight, Dr. Kissinger and I have talked for a long time about the future of the world.
Oh, I bet they have. Protected by thousands of police, their private conversations are about to resume at Bilderberg 2015. And what directed energy weapon system would be complete without science fiction sound effects? All that and more on tonight's InfoWars Nightly News.
Well, we are just days away from the official start of Bilderberg Conference 2015. Where the world's elite are going to gather to plot the future. Now, considering we are the only media outlet in the Western Hemisphere that's going to tell you anything about the Bilderberg Group, we're going to be covering it heavily this week. Our reporters are there once again on the ground, going to try and bring you any intel that we can. But you've got to look to sites like RT.com or The Independent or The Guardian to even get any minuscule reporting on what's happening there, even though this is like the world's most powerful people meeting in secret. Now, this is at the top of Drudge right now. You'll find this at The Independent. They're saying four things we know about the secret of Bilderberg Group and one thing we'll never know. So we know where the meetings are held. We know who attends them. We know what's on the agenda. And we know they take security very seriously. We've had plenty of videos showing just how seriously they take it year after year. But they say we'll never know what was said. People who attend the events don't, as a rule, talk about the specifics of what was discussed. This includes politicians whose job it is to represent their constituents. And then they just go on to regurgitate the Bilderberg press release, which just reiterates the fact that there are no minutes taken, no reports are made, no conclusions reached, no votes are taken. We know it's just a bunch of the world's most powerful people sitting around and having a polite conversation, right? Right. So we're going to give you a little flashback. This was from 2010, and it's from a former NATO security general as well as a Bilderberg attendee. And he spilled the beans a little bit to a radio station saying, Bilderberg decides the world's political and economic policies. Surprise, surprise. Just because they're not taking votes or minutes, they are actively discussing what is going on in the world and what they have planned going forward. They say Bilderberg attendees are mandated to implement the political and economic decisions that are made during this secretive meeting. This was Bilderberg member Willie Clays. Now, Clays said that attendees are normally given around 10 minutes to talk, and then they receive a summarization of what's been discussed during this meeting, and they're expected to use it when setting policies in the political and economic spheres in which they have influence. And that's why you'll see so many powerful people from so many different industries. Now, Clays also goes on to say that the participants are then obviously considered to use this report in setting their policies in the environments in which they affect. So, of course, this is once again just confirmation of what we already know, because year after year, we see the leaked agenda and then we see those things play out in the real world time and time again. Now, here, Paul Joseph Watson has a very in-depth report. We're going to show you just the last 2 minutes of it where he sums up what's on this year's Bilderberg agenda.
Bilderberg's 2015 talking points and agenda for the next 12 months. Further isolating Russia over Ukraine. Arming Ukrainian militias and potentially stoking a major confrontation with NATO. Strangling financial support for Hillary Clinton's potential 2016 presidential competitors. The elites positioning themselves as financial saviors when more riots and civil unrest unfold. Moving towards the abolition of cash and imposing economic totalitarianism. Discrediting the Out campaign for the United Kingdom's EU referendum. Rebranding authoritarianism in anticipation of the coming economic collapse. Finalizing the TPP as the next pillar of global government. Dismantling China and the BRICS countries' ability to challenge the unipolar system. Selling artificial intelligence and Big Brother surveillance as trendy and cool in order to fool the general public into adopting technology that will eviscerate their financial livelihoods and personal privacy. So that's what we know so far about the real agenda behind Bilderberg 2015, with more leaks and information to come. I'll be travelling out to Austria to join InfoWars reporters Rob Dew and Josh Owens, so be sure to check out the other videos on this channel and the Alex Jones channel as we lead the coverage for Bilderberg 2015. I'm Paul Joseph Watson reporting for InfoWars.com.
In the name of stopping ISIS, they're going to impose more capital controls on individuals. So France from September is already banning cash transactions over 1,000 euros. That's what Bilderberg's going to talk about, because the very people there are allied with the institutions and the voices that are talking about abolishing cash altogether eventually.
So it's very ironic that Bilderberg attendees are going to be discussing capital controls on consumers when several of the big banksters are going to be in attendance. HSBC is about to pay $40 million in a money laundering fine. And Douglas Flint, he's the group chairman of HSBC Holdings. He's going to be there in attendance, along with Stuart Levy, who is HSBC's chief legal officer, and Rona Fairhead. She's an HSBC director and chairwoman of the BBC Trust. I wonder if we're going to hear anything on the BBC about this. Now, HSBC was just ordered by Geneva authorities to pay around $43 million for its Swiss subsidiary's involvement in illegal money laundering. This is during which HSBC's Swiss arm banked the proceeds of political corruption and accepted deposits from arms dealers while helping wealthy people evade taxes. Nothing to see here, folks. And I'm not talking about, you know, the time they were fined $1.9 billion in 2012 for pretty much the exact same thing. So this is, you know, these are the people that are going to be talking about how they're going to be putting capital controls on you, the consumer, while they are time and time again caught doing all these money laundering and things like that, and they get a little slap on the wrist. I think they pay about 1 month's worth of fines. The total comes out to that percentage there. And of course, they're going to be talking about the abolition of cash, going on to a cashless society, more capital controls on ordinary citizens in the name of stopping tax fraud. And they're also going to be talking about stopping the financing of terror groups like ISIS, as well as discussing new controls on the sale of precious metals throughout Europe. So all sorts of things to, you know, merge us into a cashless society, which is the ultimate aim here in this global governance. We actually have the World Bank whistleblower writing into the Bilderberg Steering Committee. This is Karen Hudes. She worked for the World Bank's legal department for more than 20 years. She was senior counsel there, and she was fired for blowing the whistle on corruption inside the World Bank. And she has been speaking out about this, trying to get anyone who will listen. She says the global elite don't just control these mega corporations. They also dominate the unelected, unaccountable organizations that control the finances of virtually every nation on the face of the planet. She says the global financial system is dominated by a small group of corrupt, power-hungry figures centered around the privately owned U.S. Federal Reserve. And guess what? All of those people are in attendance there at Bilderberg, deciding how to put capital controls on you, the consumer, and move toward a cashless society, as well as artificial intelligence and, of course, how that can be used. I'm sure they're not going to be discussing at all what they're going to be doing for the millions of people who are going to be out of a job here soon, because, of course, they're backing this coming civil unrest. They're going to be figuring out how they can prop themselves up in the position to be the saviors once we do see some societal collapse, which, of course, has been being predicted again and again by billionaires, in fact, who are putting out this warning. Now, on June 8th, Hudes wrote to the Bilderberg Steering Committee, and she told him that the wizard's projection screen is no longer working. And she goes on to describe why that is so and explains how the global debt facility is working to prevent the global elite from exacting this total monetary control, because the world's monetary gold reserves are held there at the global debt facility. So they're actively working to stop them from, you know, their efforts to exact this monetary control. So basically, we are in endgame territory right here. 2016 is going to be a big year. That's why you see the U.S. and U.S. 2016 elections are also on the agenda. I mean, doesn't that concern anyone when we see, you know, some of Jeb Bush's people, some of Clinton's people there in attendance talking about the U.S. elections? I mean, that's a little bit odd for me, but also they're talking about, you know, this global governance and the slow creep of policing, of the global police force. So the New York Times is reporting how Loretta Lynch is really going to be the attorney general who's going to exact this global governance. We see that there's a growing body of law that's allowing them to prosecute foreign citizens on U.S. soil. We just recently saw this with the FIFA incident. This is Attorney General Loretta Lynch. She announced that Brooklyn prosecutors had indicted these FIFA officials from the other side of the globe. They indicted them on corruption charges. And in that case, prosecutors chose not to invoke extraterritorial jurisdiction. Instead, they relied on the defendant's use of American banks and American locations to conduct their business meetings. And that was the basis for charging them in federal court. So basically, any banking that you do, if you live in another country, if your bank has other banks that do business with America, your information is going back and forth from your country to America. And they can say that you have connections to American banks. They there can exact some control over any of your transactions there. So this is what is happening. We're seeing this global governance. It's slowly creeping here. That's on the agenda at Bilderberg. That is a huge thing. And that's why we need to have some transparency. Now, Karen J. Greenberg is the director of the Center on National Security at Fordham University School of Law. And she says the United States has become the jailer, the military front, and now the prosecutor of global crimes, particularly terrorism. And we do see the U.S. gearing up to put the troops in places all over the world. We're seeing NATO troops now are doing war games right there outside of Russia, just letting them know that we're going to be getting a little bit more aggressive. That's what Jeb Bush has said. If he's the president, he's going to become a little bit more aggressive there with Putin. So definitely setting up this World War III scenario. And of course, we have seen, you know, what a global police force looks like there, just with the Cobra security team harassing our reporters for the last few days there at Bilderberg, even though the event hasn't even begun. The world's elite haven't even started flying in yet. Now, we reported yesterday that Rob Dew and Josh Owens were stopped at the police checkpoint near their hotel. Their vehicle was searched. The police later showed up at their hotel room. Well, Rob Dew reports that today the hotel manager let him know that the federal authorities were looking for him and Josh because they were concerned about some of the YouTube videos that the guys have posted showing their encounters with police.
Hey, Rob Dew here reporting for Infowars.com and Infowars Nightly News. While we were shooting our report down in the metal art sculpture garden, talking about the different attendees that were going to be in Bilderberg, I got a call from the hotel manager where we're staying at the hotel apartment up in Buchan. And he wanted to know if I was going to be back anytime today. Because he was up at the office right now, he wanted to see if we could settle up and pay. And he had some other paperwork for me to show the cops when we were driving through the roadblocks to let them know that we were staying there. I said, well, I'm not sure when we're going to be back. We've got to shoot a few reports, and then we're going to head back up to another hotel where Josh is at, probably to shoot the show with Alex because they have a little bit better internet there. We have two hotels, two locations, and we got them just for this reason, to make sure that we had enough bandwidth. In case one place didn't have good bandwidth but was closer to Bilderberg, we'd go to the other hotel and get good bandwidth. Anyway, I said, well, that's, you know, I don't know when we're going to be back. Why? What's up? He said, well, the police were here looking for you. I said, really? The police? And I said, they came looking for me. He said, yeah, they wanted to check your passport again. And apparently it was something about some YouTube videos. And he kind of laughed. He was like, I said, really, YouTube videos? And he said, yeah. And he said, this was another part I didn't quite understand. He goes, yeah, they're, I go, is it the police that are parked up in the parking lot? Because I'll just go talk to him when I get there. He goes, no. He says, I think they're like from like the FBI office, which could mean it is the Cobra special ops people are interested in talking to us. I don't know if that's a fact, but we did do a report on Cobra. So maybe they want to talk to us. That'll be interesting. Needless to say, I want to file this report before we go up there because we're about to head back up and get some equipment and then head over to Josh's place. And if something should happen, I just want people to know that the police in here in Telfs, that's for the big buildup for the G20, are here, and they're asking for me by name, and it has to do with YouTube videos, is what I was told. So with that, Josh is driving around right now so we could file this and upload it. We're down in the Telfs downtown area because they have better cellular bandwidth. And so we're going to file this report and we'll let you know what happens after I talk to them. Also, we did shoot two other reports. We went and interviewed people in Telfs to find out what they thought about Bilderberg. Some people knew about it. I was very surprised. Some people that knew, some people didn't. We even met an American who's living here in Australia. So that report's going to be coming up. And then we Austria, you got it. Yeah, I don't know why. Sometimes I say Australia. It just rolls off the tongue better. In fact, somebody said that in the comments. Well, they said, when you tell people you're going to Austria, they'll say, I've always wanted to go to Australia. I think it's just the way they sound together. But anyway, we also have another report that we shot about the Bilderberg attendees in the sculpture garden. It's got some really neat metal sculptures. And then, you know, I'm standing next to certain ones talking about some of the attendees that are going to be there. I think the three biggest power groups are the media group, the technology group, and then the royalty politic group that will be there in for this year's 2015 Bilderberg in Telfs, Austria. And at the Interalpen Hotel, which is right up the road from where we're at now. And once again, the police were looking for me by name. They went to the hotel. And one last thing the manager said, he said, don't be alarmed if they come back at night. Well, I'm going to be definitely alarmed if the police come at night to our little apartment log cabin, because it is not near any main road, and it's definitely going to freak me out. So I hope that doesn't happen. But you never know. We'll see. I'm not doing anything wrong. I'm just here reporting on the fact that elites are getting together in secret, and the people here are going to have to pay for it, the security, the massive security apparatus, with their tax dollars. So stay tuned for more reports. It's been Rob Duke for Infowars.com and Infowars Nightly News.
Now, I'm not a real big fan of Chris Christie, but I am a fan of what he's done recently when he pardoned Stephon Josie Davis. This was a young man who was a security guard, you know, trained in firearms, proficient in firearms. And one day he put a firearm into his glove box. He was driving down the road, got pulled over by an officer. He's trying to be responsible, trying to be respectful. He said, hey, officer, I have a firearm in my glove box. You know, I'll surrender it to you now and pick it up at the station later if it's any type of a hassle. The officer says, no problem, takes the firearm, goes away. And lo and behold, Stephon is charged with a felony. And they said, you can either plead to the charge or you can face some rather stiff penalties if you try to fight this thing out in court. So he pled to the charge. Now, nobody wants to be charged with a felony, especially if you have ambitions to be a police officer, as Stephon did. So it pretty much ruined his career. Anybody who's out there knows it's a very tough job market, regardless of your education. If you have a lot of education, you may have a whole lot of student loan debt to go along with it. So he looked around to various organizations. People came to his aid, various gun groups, NRA, as well as many others, which I'm very happy to hear about. And I'll let you hear what Stephon had to say when he went to seek some aid from the NAACP and some other black organizations.
I obviously didn't fit their agenda, like I told you, and it's just
their agenda was
Black Lives Matter, but they don't matter here because I wasn't being shot by a police officer or being beat up by a police officer. You know, Al Sharpton and all the rest of the organizations, they just are not willing to help, and it's just sad because a young black man that's coming from these communities, why are they not inside the communities, sure, helping out and getting young black officers in there?
Now, I'm not trying to bash the NAACP. They do a lot of good things. But as Stefan pointed out, if it's something outside of their agenda, you know, they don't want to fight for gun rights. So even though there's a black man who's having his career ambitions dashed, they chose not to get involved in this particular incident. So I'm very happy for you, Stefan, and hope to see you patrolling your community with some good, competent policing. You can find more reports on the Alex Jones channel on YouTube.
Being satisfied with laser weapons that are both invisible and silent, companies like Boeing have announced that they're going to be taking their laser weapons to the next level. Previously, operators have had to pay close attention to know exactly when they've been firing these silent but deadly weapons. Now, their lasers will be equipped with Star Trek and Star Wars sound effects. So next time Boeing's high-energy laser mobile demonstrator shoots down a drone mid-flight, it's going to sound exactly like Han Solo's blaster. But that isn't all that science fiction has influenced. In addition to cell phones and ion propulsion and handheld devices, Star Trek and Star Wars have also influenced futurists like Ray Kurzweil. Kurzweil is once again repeating his prediction that humans will meld with computers in the future. But instead of 2045, Kurzweil is now suggesting cyborgs will be a reality by the 2030s. The director of engineering at Google said that people will soon be able to connect their brains directly to the cloud and augment their existing intelligence with thousands of computers. Thanks to DNA nanobots making the connection, our thinking will become a hybrid of biological and non-biological thinking. Kurzweil adds that by the early 2040s, people will be more like machines than they will be human. And he even suggests that we'll be able to back up our brains like a hard drive. But guess what? Star Trek already conquered this territory in the 90s.
I am the Borg.
The cyborg represents the dark side of humanity, what happens when technology falls into the wrong hands and is used to dehumanize us. The Star Trek Borgs became one with their technology. It stripped them of their humanity and their individuality. They became like zombies in a metal shell. They were now part of a collective network on a vast computer system controlled telepathically by this mysterious Borg queen. Kind of makes you think there's a possibility something could be telepathically controlling us if we ever were to upload our brains to the cloud, as Kurzweil suggests.
Assimilate this.
And even though we hear the word singularity by 2045, the fact is man merging with machine has already happened. Professor Kevin Warwick is head of the Cybernetics and Robotics Department at Reading University in the UK. In 1998, he was able to connect his nervous system to the internet via a chip implanted in his arm. He then used the web to allow him to control a robotic arm. And that was in the 90s. And he, like Kurzweil and other transhumanists, give this ominous warning that by not upgrading, we would be considered subspecies in the future. And surprise, surprise, artificial intelligence is one of the topics up for discussion at this year's Bilderberg Conference. Former DARPA director and now Google exec Regina Dugan will be in attendance. Dugan is helping to develop and promote the idea of an ingestible identification microchip. Yeah, absolutely not worrisome at all that Google is now hiring military leadership. Users would swallow a chip in pill form every day in order to obtain the superpower of having their entire body act as a biological password for cell phones, cars, doors, and other devices. But I'm sure it means absolutely nothing that artificial intelligence will be discussed this week at a top secret meeting of the world's power brokers, when people like Elon Musk and Stephen Hawking have warned that artificial intelligence has the potential to destroy humanity if it falls in the wrong hands.
I have one simple request, and that is to have sharks with frickin' laser beams attached to their heads.
You know, people don't remember when I came into office, the United States in world opinion ranked below China and just barely above Russia. And today, once again, the United States is the most respected country on earth. And part of that, I think, is because of the work that we did to re-engage the world and say that we want to work with you as partners with mutual interest and mutual respect.
He's just wrong, flat wrong, and delusional, which appears to have become the norm for U.S. presidents since Richard Nixon completely transformed the office into a den of iniquity. If he had seen the poll, his aides must have given it to him upside down. In February of 2014, a Gallup poll revealed that for the first time, the majority of Americans at 53% agreed that President Obama is not respected by other world leaders. Obama's aides probably shredded the 2014 BBC poll showing that the U.S. is 7th in mainly negative ratings under China, Russia, Israel, Pakistan, North Korea, and Iran at number 1. Maybe Obama is confusing corporate leaders with world leaders. He recently made the Brazilian and German leaders furious when it was revealed that they had been personally spied on.
I have made it clear to the President of the United States that spying on friends is not acceptable at all. I said that when he was in Berlin in July and also yesterday in a telephone call. It's not just about me, but about every German citizen.
Citizens' personal data and information have been indiscriminately targeted and intercepted. Business information, oftentimes of high economic and even strategic value, have been the target of spying activity.
We're able to end two wars while still focusing on the very real threat of terrorism and to try to work with our partners on the ground in places like Iraq and Afghanistan.
What do you make of even Bloomberg reporting that basically the U.S. is working with Al-Qaeda to take over Iraq? I mean, this is insane, and take over areas of Syria.
No, it was clear this whole operation was to, it started with getting rid of Saddam and then Gaddafi in Libya. And now Assad in Syria, Yemen, now a mess, a civil war. All those governments were secular, and now we run the risk of them being replaced by these Salafist regimes, where, as you say, they not only kill Shias, other Sunni Muslims, Christians, and other minorities, but also destroy antiquities, priceless, irreplaceable World Heritage Sites.
Execute women if they get caught not wearing gloves. I mean, give me a break, man. Our government's funding people that sexually mutilate women and make them wear gloves. I mean, I'm done. I'm done with the scum that runs our government.
Was the airdrop of weapons and supplies to ISIS really a mistake? After all, it's always been the ultimate goal of the United States and its allies to put boots on the ground in Syria and to remove al-Assad from power. The mistaken airdrop could be used as an excuse to send in U.S. ground forces. But wait a minute. Why on earth would the U.S. government purposely give ISIS terrorists weapons? I mean, these are the same Muslim extremists who are going around beheading journalists and executing Christians right now. Do you mean to tell me the U.S. government is so corrupt that they're so evil that they would actually do something like that? Oh, yes, yes, they would. And the evidence is overwhelming. In fact, the palette of weapons that has supposedly ended up in the wrong hands, what's really insignificant compared to the total ISIS arsenal. Not only does ISIS have in their possession tons of weaponry taken from the retreating Iraqi forces, but the terrorist army now has long-range artillery and thousands of automatic weapons, courtesy of the good old USA. Here's John McCain standing next to a known Al-Qaeda leader. But I guess when he's standing next to John McCain, they call him a pro-democracy rebel. Now, you like that name? That sounds like something George Orwell would have come up with. Marcos, what's his real name?
It says his name is Abdelhakim Belhaj. He's a known Al-Qaeda leader. If you have any questions about whether or not the government's actually doing this, they have been. We send people in to destabilize the region and then turn them into an enemy that gets us in the region to take control.
Flat out, we do not have Census Bureau door-to-door survey fidelity on these groups. I wish we did, but we don't. There are, by one estimate rendered last year, some 1,600 of these opposition groups. So determining their size and capability and, importantly, their ideological or political leanings is very, very difficult.
About 400 U.S. troops and potentially hundreds of additional military personnel will deploy to Turkey, Saudi Arabia, and Qatar to help train vetted moderate Syrian rebels, train and equip them. This has been the next step in the program.
Moderate rebels are virtually non-existent in Syria and have been for some time.
One of my core principles is that I will never engage in a politics in which I'm trying to divide people or make them less than me because they look different or have a different religion. That's a core principle. That's not something I would violate, right?
Obama criticizes Christians at Easter breakfast prayer. President randomly calls out less than loving expressions by Christians. Yeah, he didn't have time to talk about the hundreds of thousands of Christians killed in the last year by radical Islamists or how he was funding them. It was just, you know, there's some mean Christians that want to bake some cakes that quote the Bible, and we've all got to just shake in fear and give it a bunch of attention and act like we're all being abused and maybe have some liberals burn some more fake crosses and swastikas, you know, to get everybody fighting with each other.
On Easter, I do reflect on the fact that as a Christian, I am supposed to love. And I have to say that sometimes when I listen to less than loving expressions by Christians, I get concerned.
That's right. Let's criticize Christianity on Easter, you piece of crap.
That's a topic for another day.
We should hire 3 or 4 colored ministers, preferably with social service backgrounds and with engaging personalities. The most successful educational approach to the Negro is through a religious appeal. We don't want the word to go out that we want to exterminate the Negro population.
In the age of political correctness, you know, the comments that this woman has made, her own words, and you're going to suggest her to be on the $20 bill, it was outrageous. But you know something, the game is this. If they can flood us at one time with so many different issues and problems, we become desensitized to outrage. And that's where the church has lost its power. There is no outrage in the church any longer over these blatant atrocities, these blatant deceptions, these blatant criminal acts.
If President Obama lifted the veil of fantasy between his ears, he would discover to his own horror a presidency paved with lies and fraught with cowardice in the face of his globalist taskmasters. John Bound for InfoWars.com.
That's it for the show tonight. Please hit the subscribe button if you're watching us on YouTube, and you can also become a subscriber to PrisonPlanet.tv. Your subscription supports this operation, and it allows you to have instant access to over 18 years worth of content there. We've got the nightly news, all the special reports, the rants, as well as some ebooks that you can download. And you can share your username and password with up to 20 people at the same time. So that's 20 people that are able to watch the nightly news live with you at the same time, as well as access all of this key intel. Well, thank you for watching the show tonight, and we will see you here again tomorrow, 7 p.m. Central.